Okay. So it's for me a great honor to come here and to be invited to present you our work, the result of our work of 25 seasons of work in Europos-Dura. I will show you why I say Europos-Dura. And also, I want to tell you how it's for me dramatic to speak about. The site is now destroyed, and nothing can be done now. And some of our workers and one of our God has been beheaded. It's a really a tragedy. So I have to speak about the period before. And since we worked 25 years and I have 15 minutes, that means I try to speak about this work 2 minutes by word, by year. You can imagine how difficult it is. So you have here Europos-Dura on the Euphrates, which is an offense for the English-speaking scientists who are strong partisan of Dura. But Dura was the name which appeared the first, yes. And the English-speaking researchers are very conservative and respectful for the pioneers. So here is the site Europos-Dura. I think it's like this. Yes, okay. So you have here a map of Syria, the ancient Syria. So if you look at the map, you can see that all these sites are ancient sites from Greek and Roman period. That means Syria is very rich. The point of view of archaeology and history of the ancient period. And here you can see modern Syria. Here you have Europos-Dura on the right bank of Euphrates. And here you can see it here, just here. So you can imagine how difficult it is to go to Europos-Dura from Damascus, which is here. We have to go to Palmyra and then like this to Deir ez-Zor and here to Europos. That means one day to reach Europos. I decided to present you some photographs quickly to give you the atmosphere of the region. Here you have, below you have the Euphrates Valley, beautiful valley. And on the top you have the steppe. But you can see that there are traces of plough. So that means it's not the desert. It's good earth, but when there's rain. So it's a dry agriculture here. And on the bottom, at the horizon, you can see the fortification of the ancient town of Europos-Dura, which has been wonderfully preserved. Here is from the valley. You can see here the cliff, because part of the site has fallen in the river. You have then a wadi. Two big wadis. What? No. So, on the top you have on the right the northern wadi, which is the the dry river, which is the limit of the site. You can see the towers on the top, and on the left you have this is the southern wadi, and this is the northern wadi. So that means it is a site which is naturally defended on three sides. And with the river on the fourth side. The climate is a very difficult climate. It can be very hard. Normally we had many days when we worked there with a temperature of 50 degrees or 45 degrees, something like this. And with very often you can see the dust, the wind, dusty wind, which is also very rough. So I present you the chronology of the creation of the diggings. It was in 1920 that it has been discovered by an English Captain Murphy with Indian troops, who discovered some paintings and the fortification. Then a scientist, an American scientist, came and could visit the site in May 1920. After this, there was an expedition of two seasons under the direction of a Belgian historian, a remarkable historian, Franz Cumont. Then there were troubles in the region, everything stopped, and after 5 years you had a new expedition under a Russian historian, very famous now, Rostovsev, from the University of Yale, and he founded an expedition of 10 years, 10 seasons on the spot, with enough means, enough money to stay during 6 months a year, every year, with a huge group of workers that could be 350 workers during the campaign. So it was a huge expedition. And then there was the war, everything stopped, and it is only after 50 years that I felt in Europos for my own scientific researches. I discovered this site absolutely abandoned, and I decided to found a new expedition, which was created, as you can see, in 1986. And we worked there 25 years, 25 seasons, each season approximately 2 months a year, and with maximum of 50 workers, but often less. And then we stopped working in Europos in 2011, on the 3rd of May, when we finished our seasons, and it was the last day for us in Europos-Dura, with wonderful promise for the future, but it's like this. And now it's destruction and looting of the seat, and what you can read. No, lies. Here are the paintings which have been discovered in 1920. On the wall of this tower, which you can see here, at the angle of the fortification. That means it was a tower of the fortification which has been converted in the temple of Baal. And this is the beginning of the adventure of Europos-Dura. Here are the two huge history. Franz Cumont on the left and Rostovzev, Mikhail Rostovzev on the right. They were friends and they worked together. Rostovzev invited many times Franz Cumont to participate to the work, but Franz Cumont didn't want to disturb Rostovzev, but they collaborated without problem, and Franz Cumont came one season on. And here, on the lower image, part of the image, you can see the result of the work of digging in Europos-Dura, with the fortification, the strong fortification on the west. Here is the tower with the paintings, you see, and here you can see the bank of the river. And the bank of the river has changed, and now it is all along the cliff. That means Euphrates changes his course. Yes. Now I present you quickly some finding from Europos-Dura. You have here about 100 papyri and parchments who testify the style of life in Europos-Dura. They were all, practically all, written in Greek, approximately 15% written in Latin, and some of them in Aramean and other language from the region. Here is a mitre which has been discovered along the fortification. And you have here the representation of the Tauroboros, and here you have mitre and Sol. Beautiful paintings. Here are sculptures of the region, and here you can see the text which is written in Greek on both bas relief, yes, which represent both gods, Zeus and Mithra, and here you have paintings. You have this is from these are from houses and sanctuaries which are along the fortification. And here also you can see, for example, Heliodoros Actuarios. This is the most ancient chapel, the most ancient Christian sanctuary in the world, which is preserved at this level. It is in Yale University. But it's not the most ancient. Probably there are ruins of more ancient Christian buildings, but preserved like this, and with paintings and representation of the Bible, of the Evangelion, and so on, it's the only one, exceptional. And perhaps have you seen New York Times about the first representation of the Virgin Mary? Yes, we can discuss about this. And this is the main, the wonderful, the shadow of Europos-Dura is the synagogue, a painted synagogue. You can see here the wall measures 12 meters, and the width is 8 meters. Absolutely wonderfully preserved and now exposed in the Museum of Damascus. Here you have also, and you can see the form of the destruction of the building on both sides, which is under the earth, which has been accumulated against the fortifications. Here are arms. You have scutum, the Roman scutum on the left, and you have a helmet, a Persian, a Sasanian helmet in the site, because the site has been destroyed, not destroyed, but depopulated by the Sasanian army and disappeared from the map of the world. Here are the fortifications, how like they appear here at the beginning, and on the lower level, the fortification which have been excavated by the American expedition. So they dug all along the main the street here. The town is here, and here is outside. And you can see here big mass of earth and big mass of earth. It's not the wind which did this. On the west, yes, but not inside. Inside it was the work of the Roman who defended the site. And on the left, you have the process of defending the fortifications and the result of the result is what you have under your eyes. So, we can say that the history of Europos-Dura is between approximately 300 before, in the time of the Seleucid Empire, and 256, the date of the final battle of Europos-Dura, the fatal battle for the European Durian in the town, who were expelled from the city and who were obliged to go to Persia, probably to become slaves. And you can see here on the lower level, Sasanian Empire, Roman Empire, and just here, the turning point, the key, in Europos-Dura. Here are the some aspects of the diggings by the American expedition. You see a big mass of workers. You have the first director, Maurice Pilet, who was a Frenchman. Then there were American students of Rostov, and for example, now here, and you had a very primitive way of diggings. It was the beginning of the archaeology, the beginning of the 20th century, and archaeology was not, at this period, was not really a science. So here is the result of the site. You can see how much has been done by the American expedition. A huge part of the site, we can evaluate it at approximately one quarter of the surface, which has been excavated. And you can see here a very regular plan of a city, which is typical from the Hellenistic period, hippodamic system. And you can see a citadel on the north along the river, which has been partly destroyed. You have a palace on the north and another palace on the south. And I will present you the various kind of buildings. And on the north, you have a wall which goes straight, but only on four insulae. And this is the limit of a Roman camp which has been created inside the city. That's the only one which has been created inside the city. It's a sign. Okay. And here is the aspect of the city, of the site when we came in the beginning of the 80s of last century. You see the rain, the erosion, and the pillaging by the people from the place, and also the natural crumbling of the facades. This was the situation in Europe. And of course, I felt that it was necessary to do something. And I decided to ask the creation of the expedition. You have seen the problem of the monuments, and also I discovered that the Yale University expedition published very much. It was absolutely fantastic. I think there are very few archaeological sites which have been so efficiently published than Europos-Dura. But, of course, it's a human thing and there are problems. And for example, we discovered that some monuments were absolutely not registered and not without any information about them after they had been excavated. We had temples, you see, some temples which were not published. That means not definitely published, but we have information about them. You have temples, you have palaces, you have residences, citadel, many houses. We have other monuments which were very badly published. Fortification, for example, all the fortification, 50 pages only. And military temple, assault ramp, and so on. And also, you had other monuments which did not exist. For example, you have in front of you a temple, not one word in the archives. So it was necessary to make something, to complete the work, to save the monuments, and also I came in Europe with ideas because I worked about the creation of the towns in the Hellenistic period. And for me, it was also necessary to make some research. So I decided to create this expedition. You can see here the expedition in 2005, and you can see it's a small group of workers and small group of collaborators. But nevertheless, we had approximately between 10 and 15 collaborators working on the site, and between 10 to 50 collaborators from the country, peasants from the region, to work with us, as you can see here. So our aims were to save and preserve the site, to check the chronology on the base of factual information, to find new information to complete the history of the site. And you can see here, more precise archaeology, scientific archaeology, experimental archaeology. For example, we worked with a magnetometer to know what was under the earth in the places which were not excavated. And you can see here the plan on the left. which shows that the whole site was covered by houses. This plan has been realized by the cooperation, British-French cooperation, and I thank you, the British part of the expedition. And you can see here on the right a new plan which is practically finished and that we'll publish, which is not systematical, geometrical, like the one I presented you. It's based on 28,000 precise point of the top, on the spot, by electronic topographic instrument, and we are making it very precisely. And this will be the base of the doctorate, to study the evolution of the plan between the foundation of the city to the end of the city. And many, many new aspects will appear here. Here is the prospection around the site, and you can see here the two green lines are the limits of the zone, archaeological zone, that we decided to trace, and that has been applied on the top by the direction of the antiquities. And you can see everywhere the places where we have some measurement and studies and so on, you see. And in the middle, you have the main road to Derezor and Abu Kema. And you can see outside of the site, of the city, you have the arch, an arch of Trajan, which has been built by the troop here in 215 approximately, or 16. And you have on the north another series of lights, which are the traces of the Sasanian camp before the assault. Here, the map, on this map, you can see the places where we worked. We worked on many monuments, as you can see, monuments which existed, which had been dug by the Yale University expedition, and they are in green. And in yellow or orange, you can see the place where we decided to dig ourselves where there was nothing excavated on the spot. You see, it's very small places, but very, very fruitful. This is the final plan of the city, you see, with all the monuments which are identified. You have the blue, the palaces, you have in yellow the houses, in green the temples. You have now 19 temples which are identified on the site, and so on. And in red you have Roman bath. What did we do on the spot? We decided first to work on the fortifications. The fortification was my specialty, and I came for them. And the fortification is the way to study the history of a town. They are built when the town is founded, and they are abandoned with the abandonment of the city. So you have here in front of you the Palmyrene gate, monumental gate on the west, and here on the top you can see the work that we tried to do to protect the fortifications and to clean them to be able to study. Some of these fortifications, as you can see, they were stone fortification, and some of them, some part of them, was crumbling. And we repaired them, as you can see. We don't repair them. We didn't repair them. We tried to do not to touch of the, to the archaeological part of the monument, but to maintain it in place. And we had a study about the technique of building in stone and also on the technique of building in mud brick, because some part of the fortification were made of mud brick. And like this, we had a good history of the fortifications. And to show you a difference between the evaluation by Rostosev and by our specialists of the stone cutting, Rostosev thought that the building of the fortification went very slowly and that at the end of the city it was not finished. And what appears through the fortification is that the fortification were not built during 150 years, but could be built with 1,000 workers, everybody included, with the women with the water and the boys to bring and so on, 3 years. This is a big difference and make very important consequence in the evolution of history. Because don't forget that archaeology is history. Now we decided to study the plan of the city and the process of creating the city. For Rostosev and the science, the historian of this period, to found a city began by making the plan of the city directly and build it. We tried to check this, and you can see here how it is very regular and so on, and we worked on this theme. For example, we worked along the fortifications and we dug to make stratigraphical cutting. And we found very surprising things, that is, that the first date which appears was not 300, but 150 or 60. That means a difference of 1.5 centuries. And in the main street, which is linked with the main gate and the fortification and the hippodamic plan, we cut the main street and we made a stratigraphical cutting, as you can see here. This is a stratigraphical trench, and the material that we collected on the bottom of this trench was 150. That means it was not in 300 that the town had been designed, but 1.5 centuries after. We tried to check this. We opened other digging in the main street. You see, the main street is here. And this is an internal triumphant arch which has been built by the Roman, and we obtain exactly the same result. So, what was the conclusion? The conclusion was that the city has been founded, Europos has been founded in 300, it's written in the text, has been founded in 300 or 303 before, in the Seleucid Empire. But it was only a small point. That means a phrurion, as they say in Greek. A phrurion is a fort, a post fort, a military point, which was founded As you can see here, on the bank of the river, on the plateau along the river. Then, after 150 years after, they decided to make a huge city. They knew everything, they knew exactly the topography, they could design the city as they intended to do it. And you can see, they dug to collect stones to build the fortifications and to build the first houses with stone which were collected inside the city. And they opened carriers here, as you can see. And they had enough cubic meters to make the totality of the fortifications in stone. But they could not finish them, because 50 years after this, the Parthian came, not 50 years, but 40 years after the beginning of this process, the Parthian came, conquered the city, and they decided, the population decided to complete the fortification with mud brick. So the fortification of Europos, the ancient Europos, were built in stone and with mud brick. And it was not the process that was explained by Rostov, who said that they began to make fortification in mud brick, and that afterward they decided to replace mud brick by stone. It's exactly the reverse. So this is the process, the first stage, the small fortress. Then, during a period of approximately 100 years, population began to settle around the fortress. Then they decided, with a stock of population to put in the city, they began to build the city, as you can see here, with the quarries inside. Yeah. And then you had the final stage of the Roman city. So to make it more dynamic, you can see the beginning of the city on the left, then the creation at the situation at the arrival of the Parthian in the middle, and this is the Roman period, Roman Dura, because the Roman decided to use the name Dura, which was the name of a fortress from the 14th century before. That means Dura meant at this period fortress in Aramaic. So that means fortress and not Europos. Yes. So this is what I told you, and you have here the situation of the city, which was in the beginning of our work. So we decided to work inside on monuments and on problems, on different problems. We have worked on the plan and the fortification. Now we have here the work of our colleague, Simon James, specialist of military things in Roman period, and who published a very good book about the armament in the Roman period. And he decided to work with us, and it was a pleasure to collaborate. And you can see here, this is his place of work. And this map is Simon James' map. And you can see here the Roman military camp inside the city. That means they took approximately a quarter of the city, they removed the population from inside, and they settled here. And they built, yes, you have the principia that you have here. That means the general quarter. We can see it like this, yes. And you had the houses which has been used. And you had also some temples like Mithraeum, which was the cult of Mithra was typical for the Roman army. And also he found here an arch, and he discovered that there was a system of circulation in the Roman camp, but he will speak about, I think, somewhat, please. And he discovered very important thing, that before we could not understand how the army could go out from the camp, which was in the city. And without that, it was by the main gate. And he discovered that it was not by the main gate, but along the citadel and directly to the plain of Euphrates. And here you have a temple, a military temple here. And my dear Simon, I can offer you another military temple here, just here, that is, we discovered 15 years before, the 15 days before the definitive end of the expedition. I will present it. So, we restudy, and in the work, archaeological work that we did on excavated monument, we coupled it with restoration and consolidation of the buildings. You have a good example here. This is the palace of the Strategos. The Strategos was the chief of the town before the Roman army. We can see before 200. And you can see we restored, you have seen the facade before, and you have the final state. So it remains like this apparently. For how long time, I don't know. Here is another building which has been restudied by Ségolène de Pontbriand, and it has been practically totally dug by the Yale University expedition, but never published. Nothing, not a word about it. So we decided to publish it. So it has been re-cleaned. Here you have, on the lower part, you have the central courtyard, which is here. You have the aspect of this building. And what is interesting is that we could enlarge a bit the diggings to the south. You have here the aspect of the diggings, and what we discovered here, it's a monumental Ionic capital, 1 meter wide. That means there was, at this place, a monument from the Hellenistic period, which has been removed to build the palace of the governor of the city. And probably, can we propose that there was at this place, exactly at this place, the necropolis, the first necropolis, where the citadel was the place of the Furium. On the west of the Wadi, you have probably the necropolis and probably the tombs of the governors of the city, which is a very different image from before. This is another monument. It was also crumbling, and we decided to save it, to restore, and we discovered that there was some problem in the construction. Here you have a facade, and inside you can see a sort of theatrum, a small theater. And you can see here the restoration, but just here on the top, there are a hole in the granite, in the steps. And in the hole, there was a trace of a statue. So we decided to dig under this place of the statue, and we discovered the base of the statue. And the base is here. You can see it is written in Greek. And it was a statue for Septimios Aurelius Lysias, Strategos Caepista Teston Tespoleos Ton Europeon Temes Cae Eniken. That means it was the statue of a governor of the city in approximately 200 or 220 or 230 before our year. That means approximately 30 years before the end of the city. The governor with his titles after his death, probably the last governor, the last Hellenistic or Parthian governor of the city. 31 generation before the end of the city. That doesn't fit with some theories of Romanists. I have some colleagues here with whom I discussed. And also, here is another, it's a temple. Now, there were monumental temples. And this temple that you can see here, is the temple that you have seen under the water before. So we worked, we stabilized it, we saved many things in this temple, and we published a real new plan. But nothing very fundamental new has been found in this temple. This is another temple. This is the temple of Bel, that you have seen destroyed by the population, and where have been found the paintings. So you have the plan here, which has been published by Rostovsev, and we have restored the columns and some of the wall to the level which was attested on the photographs, to give an idea of what was the temple. And inside, we found, under the religious level, we found ovens, four ovens, and ancient ancient level, and which show that the first stage that was supposed to be in Europos of this fortification was not the first stage. And this makes some problem. And also we found some statuette and something sculpture. You see here the most typical, it's a Palmyrenian type, it's a camel with a soldier. And this is very typical of the Roman period, we can say, the Roman period of the site. And after the ancient monument, which have been discovered during the Yale University expedition, we opened new places. And this is a place which was at the end of the trench in the main street, as you see. And you can see here a new temple. When you dig in Europe, you find one time on two, you find a temple. They were very religious. I told you, we have now 19 temples in this town. And what is interesting also, that there was a courtyard, here, columns, here, and you had here a big mass of bullet of stone. That means in the last period of the town, all the buildings along the fortification has been converted in arsenals. And there were also weapons, and that we have approximately 500 stone bullets here. And also we found on this temple some paintings, as you can see on the top, which is a young warrior, and they were fallen on the floor, and also a bas-relief which is here dedicated to Bel and written in Aramaic. We opened some new quarters. This is three houses not far from the southern gate, and also we could evaluate the process of creation, evolution of houses, which was not possible through the previous publications. And we worked outside of the city, and we opened a very low tepe, approximately one meter high. And you can see here what we found. We found a Neolithic village, the remains of a Neolithic village made of stones, rough stones, as you can see. And in the middle of this construction, you have Macedonian, old Macedonian tombs. The first one which has been found in Europe. And the final discovery is here. We worked to reinforce the citadel, which was menaced. You can see the citadel and the road along it. And on the other side, you have the Euphrates. And on the top, you can see the wall of the citadel, which is bending outside. And we decided to reinforce it. Here is the work that we could do with the help of a company of cement, Lafarge. And you can see the masonry which are partly destroyed. And it was necessary to do what we did. So you can see all this wall, which is preserved since the antiquity. That means approximately 20 meters high. And we dug a trench along this wall to evacuate the water and to evacuate the humidity from the basement. And what did we find there? You can see here, in the middle of the photograph, or here, a white trace. This white trace is a trace of a building with a European roof that is not normal in Orient. European roof. And you can see here on the left, in the middle of this wall, we have the base of an altar. And On the floor, we found many pieces of paintings. You can have here the restoration of the building as it was. It was the limit of the Roman camp, but here are the paintings. This is very new, not published till now. And you have everywhere soldiers in this position. You can see here. And on three places, inscription with the name of Zeus, not Jupiter, Zeus. Boring, yeah? Okay, and you have here paintings which have been copied from the Temple of Bel And you have also soldiers here, and the tribunes, Terentius in presentation, and you have three gods here to compare. So, this is to show you the end. Now it's time to go to the end of the this conference. We'll finish with the end of the city, and you can see, as I showed you, the contact between the Sasanian Empire and the Roman Empire. And there will be a siege, a huge siege of the city. Absolutely fantastic. Here is the map of the battle. You have the city here, Dura Europos, because it's an ancient map. And you have here the three limits of Sasanian camps. That means there was a sort, probably, of coalition under the authority of the Sasanian, and three camps. And you can evaluate the surface of these camps by comparison with the town itself. It's absolutely fantastic. The surface of the town is approximately 70 hectares. So you can imagine the surface of the Sasanian camps. And they decided to besiege the city, and inside defenses of the city, they decided to defend it. So they built this mound, long mound of earth, a ramp to a sort of tell to defend, to reinforce the fortifications. And you have here on the top the Roman camp, and all the red points are the points where we have found places of battle. The main battle was in the south, but before there was a battle on the main gate and battle under the Tower 90. So I don't come back on the details of this battle, and we decided to study the main point of the battle, which is the assault ramp. The assault ramp, we know only two ancient assault ramp in the antiquity, and we decided to study it, and you have it, the assault ramp, in front of you. So I go quickly. This is the plan of the system of the assault ramp, and then you have here the assault ramp, and here is mass of earth, and this is the drawing of the battle. The Sasanians coming up here, the Sasanians coming up on the assault ramp, and here are the defenses. And finally, the Sasanians entered in the city and conquered it definitely. And finally, that is the last words. We worked also on restoration and presentation of the site. This is the construction of a museum on ancient houses with experimental archaeology. Here is a museum and a hall for visitors. And inside, on the right, and we restored also paintings in the National Museum in Damascus. And this is the last image that we left behind us on the site.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Pierre, for a masterly presentation, which, as you will have heard, the results of the Franco-Syrian project have greatly altered our understanding of the history, development, and the fate of Dura Europos.